Welcome to another exciting episode of Spotlight, where we talk to photographers, filmmakers, and people in the industry. Today, we have a very exciting guest with us, known as Antony Ochieng, who is a founder of Tony Wild. Welcome, Antony.
Thank you.
You have an interesting background. You are a wildlife ecologist and a conservation photographer. What is wildlife ecologist? You studied undergrad in wildlife conservation, and currently you're pursuing a master's degree in wildlife conservation. Maybe you can tell us more on what that is, because when I personally think of wildlife, I just think of the big cats, the buffaloes, the elephants, but I know that's not true when it comes to you.
So wildlife is broad. Wildlife is both flora and fauna, where it's plants and animals. And when you talk about wildlife management, it's how do you manage this to support people? Because we need to get benefits from these particular resources. So wildlife management entails learning how to actually sustainably use these particular resources, not just for today, but for the future. So that is what entailed the program I did in campus, yeah.
So what is conservation photography? When did you get into photography? You know, you studied wildlife management, but photography you just started 2018. So how did that come about, and what's conservation photography itself?
So first and foremost, conservation photography is a form of photojournalism where you use pictures to actually advocate for conservation outcomes or awareness. It's a subset of wildlife photography, and it's a powerful photography where it pushes for action, and people's emotions actually able to do something about a particular habitat. Just for instance, as Joel Satori will say, is that you'll have a beautiful bird life, you'll have a beautiful butterfly image, and you'll have a butterfly image with a tractor coming from behind. So the one that has a tractor coming behind communicates how human activities affect wildlife. So this picture can actually be used to advocate for change, to advocate for policies to be written down. So this kind of photography is one that it actually contributes to what I have done in school, wildlife management. It helps not only people within my field, but also people out of my field to understand how important wildlife is.
So through your photography, you're trying to tell people that wildlife is not just the big animals, and it's not just for tourists. It's for everyone.
Yeah. So for me, I define wildlife as life. The moment you remove wildlife in any ecosystem, there's no life in that particular point. So any wildlife, insects, reptiles, snakes, that is wildlife and has to be managed. So how the switch for me, it's not a switch, it's actually an upgrade to what I do. So this started way back in 2012. I would look at images from social media and I'll really ask myself, how do I really convert, how would I really be able to create what these people are creating? I would be able to go out and take a nice picture. So I didn't know much about cameras, but all I knew was about phones. So I'll buy the most expensive phones at that particular time, just to take pictures. So I'll different angles of, I'll try to do different compositions, go down using my phone at that particular time. And I remember Photo Kenya, previously called Photo Magic, had just begun. So I tried to send them an email. I was based in Nanyuki, so see if I can learn more about photography from them. But they were not able to actually have me in at that particular time because they didn't have weekend classes. They only had Wednesday classes. So I didn't have the opportunity to join them. But luckily enough, in 2016, I got a job in Nairobi. So I moved from Nanyuki to Nairobi and I was like, yes, now this is the time to go learn about photography. So that's when I enrolled to Photo Kenya for the program. And I went to that class with only one thing in mind, wildlife photography. I didn't want to know anything about other photographic things, so I just want to do wildlife photography. And when I went to that class, I was in that class for 3 consecutive lessons without a camera. All I was doing was just listening before I actually went and bought my camera. So when I went and bought my camera, I started understanding that for me to actually be able to achieve the images I want to, I needed to understand other genres of photography. So I found myself mixing from practicing from weddings to portraiture to doing festival pictures and volunteering mostly to just take these pictures together. So that's how I actually continued mastering my skill and shooting well. But in this mix, all I wanted to do was wildlife management. So I kept on doing research, and then I found a paper on conservation photography. And then I was like, yes, this is what I want to settle with. One, it upgrades my wildlife management background to be able to communicate to a wider audience, not just people who are in wildlife.
So being in Nanyuki, raised in Nanyuki, was that something that led you to being into wildlife conservation, or what motivated you and what keeps you going? Because, you know, you did an undergrad in wildlife management and decided to do a master's instead of, you know, a lot of people that were in your class after undergrad, they shifted from there and gone to other fields, you know, real estate or marketing, but you are doing a master's. What kept you motivated? What keeps you going?
For me, wildlife is a passion since I was a young person, because I can remember back in when I was in primary, we were used to go into the national park on the weekends. I think that is how the passion for wildlife actually came into place. Then in every part of my growth in terms of academic, I was always the environmental prefect. So from primary to secondary, I was only the person who was pushing for environmental stuff. So that for me, environmental issues or wildlife issues is a passion. Just after high school, I did CPAs in Strathmore. I can recall my dad telling me, you need to do a bachelor's in commerce because you've done CPA. So you'll be given an exemption of 1 year at Moi. I was like, no, what I'm going to do is wildlife management. And that is it. Let's not negotiate about it. That is it. So I went straight into wildlife management. I did it. And then I made a promise to myself that after doing the wildlife management, I'll get work in wildlife management issues. So I continuously build up that passion step by step by focusing my energies on wildlife management. So it's, for me, wildlife is a passion, a very, very strong passion for me. I can talk about it the whole day.
So you followed your passion and it has taken you places. Yeah. So you're happy about that, because you worked in a lot of NGOs. Some of them are like Kipia International Trust, Giraffe Center, BirdLife. Currently you're in Uganda for Chimpanzee Trust in Uganda. How's that experience?
It's amazing just to see what working with this particular combination, because Chimpanzee Trust needs images, pictures for their work that they're doing in conservation. But in the process, I don't just only take the images. I help them, I support them in actually implementing the projects they do, because I can see the gaps that are there. I can see the successes that they're doing, and be able to communicate that using either still or motion photography. It actually helps now inspire people to actually be able to conserve chimpanzees. So for me, it's an amazing experience. It's actually my first. They actually engaged me as my first assignment out of the country. So for me, that was so humbling, and it's something that keeps me pushing. Even as we're speaking right now, I'm just like, when am I going back to Uganda? I'm supposed to go back in a few days, but since you have the training coming up, so I have to wait.
So what keeps you, you know, what kept you going, and how did you, the motivation behind Because you're saying, you know, it keeps you motivated, you feel happy. So to build a career in wildlife conservation, I'm sure it's not an easy job because opportunities are very limited.
Yes, the opportunities are limited, but what keeps me going is when you do it out of your heart, when you know what exactly and why exactly you're doing it, it gives you the motivation to keep pushing. So I do it mainly to make people around my circles to understand that wildlife is important and we need to take the chance to conserve it. So either it's through either you're a doctor or a photographer or a business person, you need to take time and appreciate what you have. And in terms of wildlife, you need to do something and conserve it. So for me, that is why I'm actually doing it. And that is what pushes me to continue doing it. And when I get people from my peers right now talking about the way I put my content out and the way I take my pictures, it inspires me more to continue going out there and creating more content, because conservation photography is all about creating content that can inspire change in terms of environmental issues or conservation issues.
I know you've done some of your personal projects and some other projects while you're working. We can name some that have brought change, you know. Then I think you use a lot of social media to share your work.
Yeah, I should refer to myself as a digital environmental educator. Yeah. So one of the projects I will really attribute my growth to is called Traveling for Birds. So the Traveling for Birds project was one of the initial projects for Tony Wild, where we were using birds as an entry point to educate people about environmental issues. And one of the stories I used to tell people is imagine one day you wake up and you don't hear the sound of birds. In this case, I would say chicken or the hens you eat, you don't hear their sound in the morning. I know some people, mostly in the cities, will not notice that small bit of it. But just imagine waking up in the morning and there are no birds sound. There's really something wrong.
Yes.
Yes, there's literally something wrong. So for me, that was the entry point. If I can able to convince somebody else who's not in the conservation space that wildlife starts from your doorstep, or it's actually inside your house as you go out. So you need to conserve it from the house before you actually go conserve it out of the house. Yeah.
And then there's the other one that you have done, Nairobi River.
Yes.
Maybe you can, how was that experience?
So for the Nairobi River was a bit of more of a partnership or a collaboration. So there's one gentleman called Sam Dindi who was working with an initiative of helping communities living around the river, just next to Korogocho, to rehabilitate the river. And he approached me and told me, I need images for this particular project. And since you do purely images that communicate conservation stuff, please join me for this walk. So I went with him on one of the evenings, and I took pictures. And when I was taking the pictures, what made me take those pictures was how filthy that river was. And I felt if people who are living along the streams, that is from the river, comes from Kikuyu, some from Gong, mixing up until it goes through Dagoretti and the rest. If people can see what is happening down here, they can't really appreciate their actions upstream. So there's this picture of kids actually playing inside that water. There's a dog carcass in that water. There's an image that has the carcass in the river, and guys are trying to clean the river. For me, that image it's so powerful for me, because if somebody else sees the image, like, what action can really be done to actually help with the Nairobi River? And so much effort has been put just after that was in 2018. But then in 2019, just early 2019, the county government came in, started cleaning up and doing all sorts of activities with the community group that was actually doing it. So for me, those images actually help in pushing. So apart from just talking about it, because you can talk about something, but if you don't have an image to back up your statements, someone will not understand why exactly you want to clean a river that most of us do not benefit from it. So that is one project for me that actually made me upscale to be able to continually take this particular effort forward.
Okay, amazing. Maybe you can tell us a bit more about, you went to learn photography, like you said. How is conservation photo taken, or the style to take conservation photos, different from your normal wedding or portrait or sports photography? Or are they the same? What's your take on that?
The pretty much not that much different. The difference might be just you need to tell the story. You need to tell the story very, very well to be able to actually inspire the change. And you need to be specific on what particular issue you want to raise. And that's the difference. So conservation photography, you need to pick a topic and then work towards that topic. So you will find people who work in the conservation photography will pick just one species. If it's lions, it's lions. And they advocate for lions throughout 10 years. If it's insects, they'll work with one particular insect. Or if it's bats, they'll take images of bats in relation to the ecosystem. So you don't just shoot about, you do not just focus on the portraiture of the particular species, but you focus about the habitat that they found, the threats facing the habitats. So you go to the extent, but not just taking beautiful images, but also the bad images that are actually there. People littering, people are killing or eating wildlife. Those images speak a lot. People caring for wildlife. Most important, I feel sometimes people who take care of wildlife are not surely being photographed that as much as wild animals. But they take their time on a different basis to take care of wildlife. They sacrifice their life to actually be able to spend time with wildlife and take care of them. So when you're doing conservation photography, it's more of journalism. You'll have to pick each and every story, the people involved, the animal involved, the habitat, the threats, the issues. So it's different with the other genres of photography, in the sense that it does not just end at taking the picture. It goes to the extent of creating awareness and also changing policies. So it's not just about the beauty, it's about what are the issues in mind. So with the other genres, for example, fashion, most fashion photographers will want to get the bouquet. But for me, bouquet is not what I need. I need to get the whole context.
You want the whole
so
thing
my,
on the picture.
So my aperture is usually way bigger, just to make sure I have everything within that particular scope. So what I usually do is that before I go for any assignment, if I'm working with chimpanzees, I Google all chimpanzees photos taken in the lifetime that has been there, because people already worked with them before. Yeah. But then how do I go and recreate a different story? How do I do a different approach? Like, how do I tell the story of a chimpanzee in a different approach? Or how do I do a story for the Nairobi River from a different angle?
Great. So what advice would you have for the guys who want to venture in the field of conservation photography?
One, you just have to have the passion, because it's not a high paying job. You have to volunteer for quite some time for you to actually be able to actually pick up, be able to get paid jobs. But don't do it for the money. Do it for the reasons of why you're doing it. That's what I tell you. Because if you do it for the money, you get really, really frustrated and messed up. So you do it purely for what you want to achieve. So one is the passion. Secondly, pick what you feel is close to you, something that you feel that is not going wrong or right. If it's littering, to pick a topic. Like, you have to pick a topic. talk about it well. Document that topic with pictures and then share the pictures and tell the story well. Engage people. Reach out to other conservation organizations or conservation individuals who are working in that particular field and then learn from them. But most importantly is you need to understand your photography style and technique, because that is what will make you stand out from any other conservation photographer or any other photographer. And also being able to be in a family of photographers actually builds your skill, builds your scope. It gives you opportunities, because if one needs a conservation photographer right now in the country and it goes through the association, there'll be a few individuals that will be just be selected, including me being one of them. So it'll be much more easier. So in your family, you identify yourself. For example, in Kenya, we have the Photographer Association of Kenya. Joining that family for me was actually way the best growth pattern I'll actually take. Because that is where I learned not only from fashion photographers, but from sports, from creative design people, all that content coming in from the various platforms we have, which equipments to use. So that has actually really helped me grow. So for people who are coming into conservation photography, one, it's the purpose, you're doing it, why you're doing it. Two, identify yourself with individuals, organizations working in conservation. Three, be in a family of either conservationists or photographers, and you'll be able to learn in the process.
So does social media help you get in touch with the other conservationists out there? Has it made it easier than it would have before social media existed?
Social media is the eye-opening for photographers right now. So for me, social media has been my tool. For me, it's where all my images go to. It's where all I get new clients through and reach out to them. Before I had a website, I used to use my Facebook page as a platform where they can check out my work. So I started small, from the Facebook page to now building up a website and having all the images together. Yeah. So social media is very, very important.
And you also talked about knowing the equipment. So what's the equipment that you use, and maybe you can advise on why you use it, when you use it?
For me, equipment doesn't really matter. As long as you understand your equipment well, whether you have the mid, low level entry camera or the high level entry camera, whether you have a different set of lenses, all you need to do is understand your equipment well. And you go to the extent of understanding your subjects. So for example, conservation photography, your subjects are people, wildlife, habitat. That is, you can go for landscapes, macro, photography. So you have a variety of lenses to choose from. So you can go.
So you need to know what, once you've chosen the field, then.
Yeah.
Is that, yeah?
Yeah, so once you choose the topic of action, you now need to know what to do about. So for example, if you're shooting for bats, if you're working with bat researchers and you need to shoot close up of bat eyes, you need a macro lens. Or you need to figure out how you can get a proper portraiture of that particular bird. You need a low light lenses that can allow you to shoot in the dark at night, because for bat research, they usually put their mist nets in the night to be able to capture the birds. So you need to understand, one major thing is you need to understand your topic well. You need to get a researcher to tell you the process, and then from there now you know what type of equipment you use. For example, for the birds, you need a telephoto lens. But as much as you need a telephoto lens, you also need a wide lens to show the habitat of these particular birds. One of the projects I did last year was with the bird ringers from Nairobi in Savu. And we used to work, let me say, from 3 in the morning, putting up mist nets. So if you're in that team and your work is actually doing the photography, you need to be up with the equipment. The equipment has to be able to accommodate light. you need to be able to, like, the equipment really matters, but you have to really understand your subject. And the subjects in conservation photography is way, way wide. Yeah.
Oh. All right. Thank you very much. Antony Ochieng, that's who is with us. I hope everyone got to understand what he does and what conservation photography is all about. In case you need to get in touch with him, you can get him on...
You can find me on my website, www.tonywild.co.ke. Social media handle, Tony Wild, Facebook, Tony Wild KE Instagram, Tony Wild KE Twitter.
Thank you very much. Until next time.